is tonight's featured speaker. He's actually in town for workshops this month as well, so he's been talking all day, and he's still coming here to talk to us tonight. That's how important this conversation is to him. And I want to take a moment to say, I love seeing the various races here, because this impacts us all. We're all just people. Color is only skin deep. And I just love to see so many people responding to this and coming out tonight. And we're going to introduce Berwick Mahdi Davenport. He's a core trainer for the People's Institute Undoing Racism Workshops. And of course, he's also been a relationship coach for 24 years. As one of the pioneers in the field, he founded the Relationship Fitness Center in Houston, Texas, long before life coaching was even a concept. Berwick encourages people to join him on a crusade for greatness. He teaches that when power is invisible, racism and oppression thrive. Berwick's presentations not only expose the underlying purpose of racism, sexism, ageism, and classism, they also reveal how to interrupt the negative side effects, in part by teaching people to own their own power. Berwick is a graduate of McNeese State University, Landmark Education, and the People's Institute for Survival and Beyond. Please note that you've had some index cards on your seat, so feel free while you're listening to him, if you have some questions that come, write them down, and some of the child advocate staff will come and pick up your questions. We can also have conversations off of the paper as well, but that might help get the conversation started. Without further ado, please welcome Berwick Mahdi Davenport for a powerful presentation on undoing racism by making power visible.
All right, so we here to talk about the elephant in the room. And the elephant is not exactly what you think it is. But we are here to talk about the elephant in the room. So, is it on? Can you hear me? All right. I want to say this, that race is the number one social determinant of your outcomes here in this country. Depending on what your race is, it has a lot to do with the outcomes of your health, outcomes of your income, outcomes of your education, and so we have to pay attention to it. If you don't know anything about race and racism, you need to learn as much as you possibly can about it. Tonight, like I said, I'm here. I want to talk to you about the elephant in the room, right? Because there's an elephant in the room. We sit and we talk to each other and we look each other in the eyes and we hardly ever talk about the elephant in the room. Now, because we don't talk about the elephant in the room, oppression thrives. Women are oppressed. People of color are in prison at higher rates because we don't talk about the elephant in the room. Because we don't talk about the elephant in the room, poverty thrives. Because we don't talk about the elephant in the room. And once again, I would tell you that the elephant in the room is not what you think. What is the elephant in the room? We look at those things that are circled around the elephant. What really is the elephant in the room? Can you guess what it is? Huh?
Power.
Why did you say that? Because it rules everything. So I know race is a very tight subject, and we get real tense and tight around it, right? But there's something that race is trying to keep us from talking about. And if we don't talk about racism, we'll never get a chance to talk about power. So I'm here to talk to you about power. And I use that photo as an example because we're looking at power. That's looking at power. What do you notice about this photo when you look at this photo? And I say to you that you're looking at power because it's important for you to see this. You are looking at power. What do you think I mean by that? Look at the productivity. 600 businesses, 21 churches, 21 restaurants, 30 grocery stores, 2 movie theaters, 6 private airplanes, plus a hospital, a bank, post office, schools, libraries, law offices, and even a bus system. Ask me what period of time in history did this go on? In the 1920s, during the Great Depression, where America was in the worst condition probably ever, this black community was thriving. Why were they able to thrive in the midst of all of that oppression? One reason, they knew their power. Now, when you know your power, when you know it and you own it, things change. It's not moving. Yeah, it's not moving. Okay. So we're talking about the elephant in the room. The elephant in the room really is your power. Now, I want to break for a second, and I want to bring you in more emotionally because I want you to understand this from a different perspective, not just from a standard perspective. So I often talk about the story about me and my daughter, my 16-year-old daughter. Well, she's not 16 no more. She's 22 now. But when this happened, she was 16 and in high school. And so I remember doing a talk where I went and talked to a group of men about fatherhood. And I was bragging about how good of a father I thought I was. And I was really feeling myself. So that day, when I picked up from school, as I normally did, she was in high school at the time. So I picked up, she got in the car. I said, "Naja, how was your day?" She says, "Oh, Dad, I had a good day," like she normally would tell me. As always, she'd always say good. So I say, "Look, Daddy got a question for you. And I want you to know that whatever you say, however you answer this question, I'm not going to get upset." Now, this was the question. I said, "Am I a good father?" I said, "Remember what I said. I'm not going to get upset no matter what answer you give me, right?" So she looked at me in the eyes and she said, "Dad, I'm glad you asked me that question because I've been thinking about it for a while." So you know I knew I was in trouble, right? So I said to her, okay. You know, whatever, tell me the truth. Now, the truth is, what did I really want to hear from her? I want her to confirm how I was feeling because as a father and having all daughters, I played tea time, I did the dollhouse thing, and I did all that, right? Hope nobody took pictures of me when I was doing it. But I felt like I was a real good dad. So I thought it was going to be a quick exchange. You're going to say, "Oh, yeah, you're a great dad, and thank you so much for being in my life." And I was ready for it. I couldn't wait for her to give it to me. And when she said, "I've been thinking about this for a while," I knew I was in trouble. So she says to me, she says, "Daddy, you are a lousy father." I was like, "Wow. I'm a lousy father?" Immediately my voice raised. "What do you mean I'm a lousy father? How in the hell are you going to say something like that?" Then I caught myself and I apologized. I said, "I'm sorry. I remember I told you I wasn't going to get upset. I wanted to know. So what makes me such a lousy father?" And she said to me, "Because you don't listen to anything." She says, "I say things to you and I come back and I test you to see if you were listening." And she says, "I figured out that you don't listen, that my life is not important to you, and that you think we are close, but we're not close at all." Now, that was a shock. That was a wake-up call for me. Now, what was that conversation about? What do you think that conversation was about? What you said? Power. That conversation was about power. My little girl, at the time, she was coming into her power. And because she was coming into her power, she was asking questions that people ask when you come into your power. Right? So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about coming into your power and why I believe that racism, look, this is a couple of things that we say in the undoing racism training. We say that people aren't poor because they lack programs and services. We say people are poor because they lack a sense of their own power. If you ever went to undoing racism training, you will hear us say that. You will also hear us say that wherever power is made invisible, racism and oppression thrive. So that's a big thing, right? It's a big thing that racism is really working to keep and make power invisible. Because people do things that are extraordinary when they have a sense of their power. So everything about what we do is really about making power visible. Every step we take you through in the undoing racism training is about in some way helping you see what your power is or get a sense of it. So I want to do a couple of little exercises to help us understand why we have such a great trepidation around power. I want to show you something first, though. So, you know, this is what happened to Tulsa, Oklahoma, to what we call Black Wall Street. It was destroyed, right? And that destruction, that military might, that destruction, imprinted us with fear in our hearts about what our power can do, right? Look at that image. Every time I look at that image, it chokes me up, because you're looking at probably a five-year-old boy carrying his dead brother as a result of their community, which was thriving, which was produced by power destroyed because of racism. So racism is real. It's very real. And even though that's in the 1920s, it's still real. And that still reverberates in our DNA, the fear, not of this destruction, but the fear of what our power brings on. So we have a fear. We have been made to be afraid of our power. We have been made to be afraid of our power. That there is absolutely nothing you can get done in this world without power. Nothing you can get done in this world without power. You need power to be able to get the things that you want. First of all, let's talk about for a second, what are the things that power gives us? Because we don't talk about power. Power is a missing conversation from our meetings. It's a missing conversation from everything we get together about. We don't talk about power. Am I the only one that sees that? I go to a lot of meetings. I've attended a lot of meetings, and I go to a lot of gatherings. And what we find is that people are not talking about power. You don't find that kind of funny? You need power to get things done in this world, but we don't talk about it. We're not asking the questions about where it is and where it's not. So in the undoing racism training, we do a power analysis. Because we want you to get a sense of where power is and where it's not, right? So I want you to get a sense of your power, because that's very important. Because if you don't get a sense of your power, listen, we can do all of this, make all the structural changes we want in institutions. But as an administrator once said to me, you can make all the structural changes you want, but a toxic culture will eat structure for breakfast. And toxic cultures come from people that don't know what their power is. They don't have a sense of their power. We become destructive and we make toxic cultures. And toxic cultures eat structure for breakfast. So let's get a sense of what power is and how power has been misunderstood so much among people in general. How many of you would like to have more control in your life? More control over your life? Raise your hand. Don't be shy, raise your hand. If you'd like to have more control in your life. All right, good, good, thank you. Now, how many of you would like to be controlled? Raise your hand. What just happened? You just said you wanted more control over your life. But now when I ask you if you want to be controlled, nobody raised a hand. What did we just discover in this little experiment? What did we just discover?
We all want power.
We all want power. What else? We have a choice. What else?
We don't want people to have power over us. We don't want
people to have power over us. Good. Anything else? So to have power, someone has to give up power. Interesting. What else? Because there's something very subtle that you're not getting, but it's big, it's huge.
Shared power.
Shared power? Okay.
Nobody wants to be controlled.
Nobody wants to be controlled. That was obvious, right? So what it means is this. We don't understand what power is because we think power is control. Power is not control. How do we know that? Because you don't want nobody to control you. You want power, you want control, but you don't want nobody to control you. So now I'm asking this question. Where are you going to take your control to? When you get the control that you want over your life, where are you going to take it to? Where are you going to take it to? To your relationships, right? Now, you just heard everybody say they didn't want it in their life. Right? So how do we get control into our relationships? How we get them in our relationships? We sneak it. Think about if you were sitting down having dinner with someone that you just started dating and you're really liking each other, and and he says to you, baby, I'm really digging you, and I'm gonna control you as often as I can. What would you do? You get up and leave, right? Because we don't want to be controlled. But there's something else that control reveals, is that control splits us. Control divides us within ourselves. It immediately created an ambivalence, a split, because you want it and you don't want it. So we want something that we really don't want. So now, that has been the problem with power, because we've thought that power was control, and we've been fighting to get people away from us that want to control us all our lives. So if we've been fighting what we think was power, that means that we've been pushing power away. We have not been moving close to power, we've been moving away from power. Now, what are the things that power give you? What things will power give us that we can't have without power? What are some of those things? A sense of self, okay, good. Well, I wouldn't say control over activities in your life, but it give you some charge of it, right? What else? Huh? Influence, beautiful. What else? Respect, opportunity.
More choices.
Good. Access.
Time.
Time,
space, and voice.
Yes. Peace, freedom. Now imagine without power, we don't have those things. But what we have been socialized to believe about power is something like power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And so we've been ashamed of embracing our power. We're afraid to talk about it. So we want power, but we don't say it out loud in front of people. How many of you have ever said, I want my power? I demand my power. We won't say that because we have been made to be ashamed of power, which is what racism does a great job of, making your power invisible so that you won't be able to hold institutions accountable. People that don't have a sense of their own power cannot and will not hold institutions accountable. Follow what I'm saying? All right, now let's go a little deeper into this, because control, the desire for control divides us, it splits us. So we're not operating whole. We're operating with, in doubt about it. Now, here's another question. Raise your hand if you'd like to have more trust in your life. Raise your hand. Good. Raise your hand if you'd like to be trusted. What did you just learn?
Trust is important.
Very good. What else? Huh? You want it and you want it. There's no split in us about trust. What else? Huh? You're united. Trust keeps us united within ourselves. So if we united, it means we come into the table whole, right? So now, a society, how does a society work? We live in a universe that is built on trust. Everything in the universe operates on a trust, not on a control. So what kind of trust you have in your life? Let's see. How many of you have children? Raise your hand if you got kids. And they go to school. How many of you drop your kids off to school? All right, you drop them off, right? And you go to work. What is that? How many of you got money in the bank? Maybe tomorrow. So if you got money in the bank tomorrow, what is that? Isn't that trust? How many of you go out to a restaurant and sit down and eat a meal in the restaurant? Do you go in the kitchen and cook with them? No. That's a what? How many of you lied next to somebody at night and closed your eyes? Maybe one eye open with you, you know what I'm saying? How many? What is that? You see, what I'm getting at is this, is that we don't understand what power is, because if we did, we'd have more of it. We have been taught that power is control, and power is not control. Power is more about trust than it is about anything. And the more trust you do, the more access or the more power you gain. Now, Let's talk about this a little more. I'm going to go further in my slide. Remember this poem Marion Williamson put out some time ago, that our greatest fear is that we are more powerful beyond imagination, right? I do believe that. I believe that we are afraid of our power because we've been socialized to be afraid of our power, because our view of power has been destructive. So we have not wanted power because it seems destructive. But get that, you can't do the things you really want to do with your life if you don't have it. My two daughters, my youngest daughters, and that's what they told me. They said, "Daddy, we don't need you to be good. Daddy, we need you to be great." Now let me tell you something, because this has everything to do with power. When you start owning your power, you go from good to great. Get that, good people and great people don't do the same thing. People who are aspiring to be great do not do the same thing as people who are aspiring to be good. Now, what does it mean to be good in this society? What does it mean? Huh? Following the structure, the order, what else? Acquiescing, your power, fitting in. So when people tell you, you're such a good man, that means you're following the model, the status quo model of this world. When you get a sense of your power, you start understanding something, that good is not good enough. Listen, it's because of our goodness we haven't tapped into our greatness. And I remember when I first was introduced to this, when I was reading this book written by this guy by the name of Jim Collins, who wrote this book called Good to Great. In the opening line of his book, he says this, and it stuck with me some 12 years ago. He says, good is the enemy of great. That if we're going to be great, we're going to have to give up being good. If we're going to be great, we're going to have to give up being good. Now, I know that's hard for some of us to hear because we've been striving to be good a lot. Now, this good thing is really about us trying to be a certain person for someone else. Us trying to please and fulfill other people's wishes. Great is about doing what you've come here to do because you understand what your power is. So let's talk about power. So the problem is invisible power. When your power is not visible, you can't be all that you are. What is the purpose of power? What is the purpose of power?
To control?
No. See, that's what we've been taught. We've been taught that. But that's not the purpose of power. What is the purpose of power?
Be able to get things done.
Be able to get things done? Okay, what else? Make everything possible? Okay, what else? Huh?
Being creative.
Okay, not in the box. All right, good. What else? There's something we're missing. That power is so important, and it is the primary purpose of power.
Having a sense of your own self.
Good. Power is basically to help you maintain your integrity. Power is designed to help you maintain your integrity. What do I mean by integrity? I'm not talking about morality. I'm talking about the way you work right. Everything has a certain way it works right, and it's called integrity. So when you stop operating correctly, you start operating wrong, you're outside your integrity. When you are trying to be something for other people, you are operating outside your integrity. Power is that thing that it gives you the ability to operate in your integrity and to maintain your state of integrity in the midst of the world wanting you to be something else. See, there's a dilemma that happens when we come into the world. We come into the world, we have it out, we have our agenda, our life purpose. But then there are people that we love and care about who think that we should be doing something different than what we think we should be doing, right? And so what begins to happen? We start wanting to please them. And so that conflict is developed in us. So power is designed to give us the strength to say, nah, I'm going to stick to what I come here to do. And I'm not going to worry about trying to please everybody else. All right? So making power visible is really what I consider the solution, that we got to work to make power visible in people's lives. Now, how can you make power visible in people's lives if it's not visible in yours? How does that work? Does it? This morning, I was talking to the staff of Child Advocates, and we were talking about how the kids come in feeling like they're not enough, and how important it is for us, when we meet them, that we help them get a sense that they are enough. But we can't do that if we don't feel like we're enough. Because see, when you don't know what your power is, you think you're not enough. Now, how does life occur to someone who thinks they're not enough? As a person of color, let me tell you something, that's a painful thing. I've lived most of my life thinking and believing I wasn't enough because of racism. Because of the messages I received from racism growing up, I felt like I wasn't enough. And so most of the things I did was designed to try to prove to other people that I was enough. And no matter what I did, it wasn't enough. Because see, we have a thing called an ego, right? And in this race construct, our ego is played on a whole lot, right? So I'm gonna give you a little definition for the ego to help you to understand how it's played on by you understanding what it is. Carl Jung, the psychologist, once said this about the ego. He said that the world will ask you who you are. And when you are unable to say who you are, the world will then tell you who you are. And who the world tells you are becomes your ego. Now, let me summarize it. Your ego is simply who you are trying to be for other people. Who you are trying to be for other people, or who you think you should be for other people. Now, here's how the ego works with you. Ego tells you, sister, you're not good enough. You're not pretty enough. You're not tall enough. You're not this enough. And to get pretty enough, you need to get this. And when you get this, you're going to be pretty enough. So you go out and you get that. And then you look at yourself and you're still not pretty enough. Because your ego won't let you be pretty enough because you're trying to be something for somebody else. So they are the ones determining it, not you. So we say, okay, when I get this amount of money, then I'm going to really be me. You get that money and it's still something else. Your ego is constantly creating prerequisites before you be good enough. And it's the part of the trap. It's a part of the scheme to keep you chasing behind this idea that there's something else you have to be that you're not already are. All right? So making power visible is so important, because when you start getting a sense of your power, you know what happens? It brings you to enough. I have a thing, I call it the principle of enough. The principle of enough. It's a powerful principle. I want to share it with you. The principle of enough states this, that at the point in time in your life when you begin to see yourself as an asset, you become enough. Now, what does enough mean? It's profound. I love it. What does enough mean? Huh?
Isn't that a personal?
Very personal.
Very.
Very personal. What does it mean? Enough.
You're whole.
Huh?
You're whole.
Okay, what else? Good. What else?
Contentment.
Huh? Contentment. Good. What else?
Others.
Worthy. Huh?
Others don't define,
others don't define you.
Self-acceptance.
What else? I love the way the dictionary puts it, right? Because the dictionary have a nice little definition to go with it, and it says, nothing else is needed. See, when you find your power and you embrace it, you get to enough, and when you get to enough, nothing else is needed. Now I can take all this stuff off. I can stop fronting, because most of us spend most of our lives pretending because our ego has us trying to be something for someone else, and it is exhausting. And in a race-based society, because of the position that we've been in as people of color especially, we have been so many different things for everybody. And it's like we walk around carrying the weight of all the people we've tried to be. And if we don't embrace our power, start understanding how to get close to our power, what happens is we never know we're enough. Now, when you reach the principle of enough, what do you stop doing? Being a copycat, what else? Trying to satisfy other people's expectations, good. What else you stop doing? You stop pretending. You stop searching. You know what you stop doing more than anything? Wasting your life. In this search to try to prove something to people, we're wasting our resources, wasting our life, wasting our time. When you get that you're enough, hey, that's when the party starts. You really start enjoying your life the minute you get to that principle of enough and you understand that you are enough. Now, there are things that we've been taught that make us believe that we're not enough, that we're going to have to deal with. One of those things is, when I say this, people are going to get mad with me, but I got to say it. One of the principles that exist in most of our lives is this idea that we've all fallen short. Did I step on any toes? That we've all fallen short. We've been taught that. We've been socialized that. And that is not true. But if you believe that you've all fallen short, that we've all fallen short, that means you'll never be enough. You never balance the equation. All right, so let's talk about how some things that we can do to start getting a sense of our power. The first thing is you got to understand that the door to you getting a sense of your power is for you to understand racism, and undoing racism is one of the most powerful experiences you could have to begin to start walking you through the door of becoming aware of your power. If you don't understand how race and racism was put together, you don't understand how your power was hidden from you. So we want you to understand how your power became hidden. So you can start looking for it. You can start asking the questions, where is my power? How do I get my power? Right? So let's define power. I don't know if I put the definite, come on. What is power? What really is it? What is it? Is it that? Is it brute physical strength? It could be. But what is it? What is power? Huh? Your integrity. Good. I like that. Right? I was asking this question in a workshop in San Francisco, and there was a young lady from Colombia. When I asked the question, what is power? She says, in order for us to understand power, you got to study the nature of relationships. She said, into the nature of relationships. And she was correct. That if you're going to understand power, you got to understand relationships. Now, here's the thing. How many of you are in a relationship right now? Raise your hand. We all are. Everybody's hands should be going up. I'm not talking about a significant other all boo. I'm talking about all of us are in relationship with each other. Now, if we're all in a relationship with each other, how many of us have experienced or had a formal relationship education? Raise your hand if you had a formal relationship education. You see that? Now, why do you think that is? The whole world runs on relationships, right? But none of us have been educated on how to have relationships, to be great at relationships. So we all are relationship illiterate. It's not by accident. We are not taught about relationships because relationships take you straight to power. When you start examining, why are we together? Why are we together? When you start asking questions, what do you want from me? See, I got this thing, look, from doing this work that I've been doing around relationships for all these years, that until a person tell you what they want from you, they're not honest. And if you can't say what you want from someone else, you're not honest. Here's what the purpose of relationships are. The purpose of relationships is to connect you to resources. That's what relationships carry. That's why they call ships. They're relationships. They're carrying resources. And they come in and out of your life to bring resources in your life. But when you are not aware of your power, you don't even know, or you be afraid to even say what resources you want. I know people that have been around each other for years, and they say they've been friends. I said, what you created together? Nothing, we just good friends. Wasting resources. If we're going to be in each other's life, we need to be clear about what we're getting from each other, what we're exchanging, what resources we are exchanging, right? What is a resource? What is a resource? It's a need or want. A resource is a need or want.
And it's something that
Okay.
Sometimes it's limited.
Okay. What else? What is a resource?
A means to something.
A means to something? Good.
A tool to improve.
A tool to improve. It's a tool, correct, right? Anything else?
Something you use in life.
Now, when you look it up, you'll find, I like this little word they use in conjunction with resource. Say a resource is an asset. Now, how many of us see ourselves as assets? Beautiful. Because until you see yourself as an asset, you're not going to be enough. The word asset, when you look up the etymology of the word asset, guess what the etymology of the word asset is? Enough. Isn't that astonishing? That the etymology of the word asset is enough, because once you see yourself as an asset, most of us, we exist our entire life seeing ourselves as a liability. As a liability. Now, here's what power is. In the Institute, we would talk about power in two ways. We talk about power, institutional power, and we tell you that institutional power is what is it, Diana? Institutional power.
Oh, legitimate access.
It's legitimate access to systems and institutions sanctioned by the state. That's how we define institutional power. Legitimate access to systems and institutions sanctioned by the state. In other words, we're saying that the state has some resources that is legal. If we want to have access to it, it's legal and it's sanctioned. But there's resources they have, right? Now, where those resources come from? Huh? The people. But we've forgotten that. Because we don't have a sense of our own power, we've forgotten that institutions harvest their power from us. So what is our power? How do you define our power? I define our power as simply this: the awareness of the resources you have access to. The awareness of the resources you have access to. All of us in this room right now are resource abundant. All of us in this room are resource abundant. The problem is we're not aware of what resources we have. We haven't done an inventory of it, an assessment of it, but we need to do assessments of all the resources we have available to us, right? Not just in the institutions, but among ourselves. So now, how do you think Black Wall Street was able to do what they did? They were locked out. They were completely locked out. You think things are bad now? Things were a million times bad then. But they did what? They pooled their resources. And the dollar circulated in their community over 11 times before it left the community. Because they pooled their resources. They were aware of their resources and began to pool them. And when you become aware of your resources, and get this, and you start to rely on your resources. See, our problem has been we haven't relied on them, and we haven't even taken inventory about what resources we have. You should not be in anybody's life that comes into your life without asking them, what do you want from me? What can we exchange, and what are we going to do together? I'm not hanging out. We ain't going to be no partners. My grandmother used to tell me all the time, boy, don't have no partners. Because a partner is a bad thing. Unless you are doing something together, unless you're creating together, you're wasting your time. I'm talking about even in terms of you get married, you love each other, what are you going to create together? The questions we need to be asking ourselves when we own our power is all about creation. It's all about what we're going to create together. Because we have the resources to do it, right? So I want to tell you, I want to give you five things that we can be able to do. I think it's necessary to be able to get present to what your power really is, to feel your power. Because most of us, power occurs to us as only a concept. It doesn't occur to us as something that we feel. And if until we feel our power, power is not real. Would you agree with that? That until we can feel it, it's not real. So here's the first thing that, you know, that I suggest that we do to get a sense of our own power personally, all right? I want you to start practicing translating the meaning of things to you, to other people. Let me say it again. I want you to start practicing translating the meaning of things to you, to other people. See, because when you're not enough, this is what we do. When we think we're not enough, we never tell people what things really mean to us. And so people don't get a chance to get to know us. People be in our lives and they think they know us and they don't know nothing about us because we didn't have the courage to tell them what things really mean to us. Get that, people can't get to know you if they don't know what things mean to you. People don't know us, they know what things mean to us. That's how they get to know us. Everybody got that? And I want you to get that no two people have the same meaning. Meaning does not translate. When I tell you something about what things, about something with me, I could assume that you it means the same thing to you, but it never does. So I need to make sure I'm translating what things mean to me to you. That's the only way we're going to have real relationship connection. The second thing is we got to start doing, this is like profound. We got to start demonstrating respect. Because racism has taught us to be so disrespectful and we don't even realize it. Now, what is respect rooted in? Respect is rooted in the idea that no two people ever experience the same thing. That's a universal law. No two people ever experience the same thing. Now, I know what you're thinking. Yes, they do. Two people can be in the same event together, but being in the same event does not mean you're in the same experience. It's two different things. Two people, for example, riding on an airplane, both in their 70s, two older ladies, and the plane almost crashes. It doesn't crash. One says, girl, when I get home, I'm going to get my life insurance policy together, my burial information, make sure my kids know, because this scared me to death. The other one said, girl, I don't know about you, but I'm going to live. I've been holding back for too long. I'm going to climb some mountains. And she'll go climb some mountains because she has decided to make out of that event time for me to live. So none of us have the same experiences. But get all the arguing we do about trying to get people to believe that our experience is the best experience. That's what racism is all about. Racism is about getting us to believe that one group of people, their experiences, is the standard experiences. So what has it created? Us not feeling like we're enough? You know what it's created? We've been chasing other people's experiences. We spend more time chasing behind other people's experiences than we do honoring and respecting our own experiences. Now get this, when you go on a job, right? And you're interviewing for a job or you're applying for a job, what do you send in? Resume. And what the resume have on it? Your what? Your qualification, more importantly, your experiences. And you're gonna get paid for what? Your what? For your experiences, for your experiences. You ain't gonna get paid for my experience. So you can chase behind other people's experiences all you want. You're not going to get paid for trying to chase behind my experience. You're going to get paid for chasing behind your experience and owning your experience. Most of us spend our entire life being ashamed of our own experiences. And if you are ashamed of your experience, you will never be able to feel your power. You got to own your experience, honor your experience, even treat it as sacred. So when it comes up and you kind of ashamed about what your experience is, you better own it. Because the universe is going to pay you for your experience. It ain't going to pay you for mine. Our lives are, in terms of how we come to wealth, has a lot to do with our relationship to our own experiences. But if you're ashamed of your experience, it don't happen, right? The third one, you got to start listening. Just like my daughter told me, look, daddy, you ain't listening. We got to start listening. Listening is so important. Listen, people learn how important they are or how unimportant they are based upon how they listen to when they're children. We come to that conclusion at a very early age. I'm important or I'm not important based upon how well our parents listen to us or don't listen to us. Now get this, most of us, we have grown up in a way where we haven't been listening to ourselves. We want other people to listen to us. We can't wait till we get a crowd so we can start talking. But how often do you listen to yourself? How often do you follow the advice you give to other people? See, a lot of us are quick in a hurry to give advice to other people. We want everybody else to follow our advice. But we don't follow our own advice. Now, until you start following your own advice, you're not going to understand what your power is. Everybody follow me? You got to start listening to yourself more than you want other people to listen to you, because when you start listening to you, everybody going to start listening to you. This is what I did for my daughter. Well, I did it for myself. When my daughter told me I didn't listen, I went on a talking diet. And for three years, I did this. I talked 20% and listened 80%. Ooh, that was hard. Oh, my God. I ain't gonna lie, that was a serious diet. It was hard. But here's what I discovered. I discovered I was missing my life. When I started listening to the moments in my life, I discovered I was missing it. Because here's what I should do. I look into your eyes while you're talking to me. What's your name?
Rick.
Rick. Rick will be talking to me, and I'm looking at Rick straight up, and I'm saying, when Rick gonna shut up? Will Rick shut up? In my mind, because I'm not really listening to Rick, I'm pretending to listen to Rick. And I thought I was going to get away with it just like you think you're going to get away with it. We all think we're going to get away with pretending to listen. You're not going to get away with it. You're going to pay the piper at some point. So you can start listening now or you can listen later. I have a girlfriend who works in hospice. You know what that conversation is about, right? And she says every single person that she is set next to that was transitioning, that she was able to be there with when they transitioned, said one thing: I wish I would have had more time. I wish I would have had more time. Most of us die without fully living because we miss out on our life because we're not paying attention to our life. We are so outside of our power that all of our attention is focused on other people. What she got, what she ain't got. And that's what happens when you feel like you're not enough, you're constantly performing. You constantly feel like you got to do something to add up, and you waste your resources, and one day you wake up and you're like, oh my God. See, when my daughter did that for me, she did me, she just don't know how she blessed me. Because when I started listening, I started realizing I was missing out on so much. I didn't know what my resources were. I was misusing my resources. So now here's a principle that I live by that I want to share with you. I live my life like I don't know how much time I have left to live. I live my life like I don't know how much time I have left to live. Now, is that true? Hell yeah. And every morning when I get up, I remind myself of, you don't know, today could be your number. Get that, how some of us approach life? We approach life like we know we got all the time in the world. Oh, I'm going to tell such and such I love them next week. I'm going to really go see my mother next week. I'm going to really get on the phone. I'm going to really do such and such. And we always putting stuff off like we know how much time we got. You don't know. This could be the last time you ever hear from me or see from me. You say, well, I remember that guy. That's a shame he passed away. But guess what? I'm giving it all I got. I'm giving it all I got because I'm going to tell you why I'm giving it all my got. Because I know I'm enough. When I got in touch with my power and I started owning my power, I started relying on my resources, start trusting my resources, I realized, damn, I'm enough. When I walk into the room, I'm enough. Shame on you if you don't know it. But I'm not going to make myself small to make you comfortable. Because that's what we do when we don't know what our power is. We shrink so that other people can feel comfortable. People will tell me I'm arrogant all the time. Thank you so much. And the reason why I say that is because we have not developed a language of power. So we don't have positive words to say about people who are owning their power. We say negative things. Who do you think they are? They're always trying to take the lead. And we got all kind of negative stuff to say about them. She thinks she this and that. Look how she walking. Look how she talking. Keep doing your thing. Keep doing your thing. The fourth thing is this. Oh, this is the hardest one. We got to be honest. You will not connect to your power fully until you start being honest. The only language in the universe that works is honesty. is honesty? As I'm moving to the wrap up, I just got my cue. What is honesty? I want to give you a scenario, and it's going to help you to be able to see what honesty really is. There's this lady, based on a true story, married 10 years, having an affair for two. Her and the guy who she's having an affair with, they meet at the hotel separately. He gets there before her, and she meets him. They do their thing. He leaves first. She sticks behind. Nobody ever see them together. They got it going on. They got that thing going on, right? On this particular occasion, he leaves. She's left there in the room. She starts having a heart attack. Yeah. She starts having a heart attack, so she gets on the cell phone, calls the operator, and she says, she dials the operator, and she says, "Operator, I think I'm having a heart attack." What the operator says, 911, what's your emergency? What's your name and your emergency? She says her name, says what emergency is. I think I'm having a heart attack. She describes the symptoms. The operator says, "Yes, ma'am, it sounds like you're having a heart attack. Please tell me what is your location." And she says, "I can't tell you, because if I do, everybody gonna know." Now, what you think about that? Crazy, huh? How about we do it every day? How about we do it every day? How about we complain about stuff all the time that we want help on? How about we get on our knees and we pray and ask for things all the time, and then when we get in front of certain people, we pretend the very opposite? How about they ain't know the paramedics cannot reach you if you don't give your accurate location? How about we spend most of our life giving inaccurate location, telling people we're places that we're not? I remember when I was going through some financial struggles, I used to still front in front of certain people. I used to act like I had it going on. Now get this, none of the help that you want can reach you if you don't give your accurate location. See, honesty is about you giving your accurate location. Honesty is about you making yourself vulnerable, you opening yourself up for a possibility. You cannot be honest for no one else in this room but you. We be in a hurry to tell the truth about other people. I'm gonna tell the truth. I can't wait to tell the truth. No, the only truth you're responsible for is your own. And get that, I don't know what your belief is about God, but trust me, if you believe in God, God already know your truth already. You ain't saying nothing that's gonna slap God. So being honest is not about what you're saying to God, it's about what you're saying to other people. The last thing is that you gotta stay on your growing edge. You gotta stay willing and ready to grow. When you meet up with uncomfortable situations in life, stay ready to grow. Because growing is how you grow into more of your power. The more you grow, the more access to resources you get, the more powerful you become. But you gotta be willing to grow. Some of us are not willing to grow. Expose yourself to situations where you can grow and get bigger and bigger and bigger. So I'm gonna stop right there, and I'm gonna entertain questions, right?
You still have 10 minutes.
Oh, I got 10 minutes?
Yeah, go.
Oh, wow.
10 minutes for questions.
Okay, I thought, okay, shoot. Okay, all right, so I want to talk about something that we normally talk about, because what I'm doing right now, this part, this five things that I gave you, is a part of what we call the contract. When we do the undoing racism training, we do a contract. And really what that contract is about is really sort of like orientating you to your power. And it's also about getting you to come into an agreement that we all gonna have power in this process. We all gonna have power in this process. So when we get to the growing edge, we normally say something like this. We say that there are five realms of knowing. All right? Now, there is what you know. All of us know we know something. And if somebody asks us a question about what we know, we raise our hand real quick because we know it. All of us have something that we know we don't know. There are certain things we know nothing about. And if somebody called on us, we'd be like, "Hold up, don't call my name. I know I don't know it." Those two areas are not what a growing edge is. The growing edge is in the third and fourth realm. The third realm of knowing is that there are things that you think you know that are wrong. And when you discover that you're wrong, our ego has a tendency to what? Want to fight to make it right. And what we tend to do is we tend to disengage the conversation. We tend to get out of the growing edge. We tend to, you know, give up on growing. We say to you, please stay engaged in that moment when you feel that, because you are getting a sense of more of your power. The fourth one is, there's what you don't know, you don't know. You could come into contact with what you don't know anywhere you go. But even when we come into contact with what we don't know, what happens? We tend to disengage because we be embarrassed, because our ego wants to be right. Our ego wants to be right, people. The last thing, the last realm of knowing is that there are things that you know intuitively that you don't know you know. And we say that's the goodest. Because when you are honest, right, and you stick with the growing edge, what you get to is the intuitive knowings that you have already that you don't know you know. There are some things that you don't even know you know that are so profound that if you start listening to yourself and you start embracing yourself as enough, you blow everybody's mind. You say profound things all the time that you never say to other people because you doubt yourself. You get what I'm saying? I was in St. Thomas in the Virgin Islands, supposedly on a vacation. And I went and I took part in this fire ceremony that this Indian guru was facilitating around this pool at this resort. And it was real nice. It's called a fire purification ceremony. So before we did the ceremony, he came out and he talked a little bit about what we're getting ready to do. And he said to us, he says, you know, throughout the annals of time, man has been willing to give up everything for this one thing. What do you think the answer is to that? Huh? Power? Nope. Love? Nope. Huh? Money? Nope. Nope. Huh?
The fire?
Nope. Knowledge? Nope. We were saying all the same thing. We were saying money, power, sex, family. We went on and on and on. He kept saying no. So everybody getting frustrated, right? Nope. Nope. We felt the same way. We was like, well, damn, what the answer is? So he said, you want me to take you out of your misery? He says, no. He says, throughout the annals of time, man has been willing to give up everything to be right. And I tell you what, when he said that, it hit me right in the center of the forehead. Because I gave up so much to be right. We will fight, your ego will have you fighting for right all day long. And guess what? When you fight for right, you know what's going to end up happening? You're going to walk away with nothing. Oh, by the way, that's what the ego wants to leave you with. Nothing. This morning I was giving a good example. You see a married couple, because I work with married couples and and organizations, but you see a married couple and they come in and they're having, arguments and whatnot. And they could argue all day. They tell you their side of the story and it goes on and on and on and on. But what you find is this, that, like, take for example, the guy would be at work all day and he's thinking about being with his wife. He needs a hug. He needs some affection. That's all. He wants some affection. But his wife didn't call him like he thought she was supposed to, right? So instead of, when he gets home, instead of going for what he really wants, which is some affection, he starts an argument to prove how wrong she was for not calling him. Now, after arguing with her about her being wrong and making her wrong for not calling him, she's not in the mood to give him no affection. So he walks out of the situation not getting what he wants, but he was right. Some of us keep going into scenarios and situations in our life working to prove we are right, and we walk out without what we want because we make being right more important than what we want. And every time you do that, I want you to know that's your ego leading you by the tail. And if you don't learn to distinguish your ego from who you really are, from your authentic self, which is what has power, your authentic self, your ego does not have any power at all, so it wants to leave you with nothing. No happiness, no joy, no fulfillment, no power. Your ego has no identification in this universe because it's not real. So when we follow it, we always end up moving away from what our power is, in summary. Your power is your awareness of the resources you have access to. Trust is so important because if you don't trust, you never learn what you can do with your power. So your power sits there and you do nothing with it. So I'm telling you that control is not what power is. I'm telling you that trust is more about what power is than anything. And anywhere in your life where you have control, guess what you don't have? You don't have trust. You know what the definition of insecurity is? What the etymology of insecurity? The etymology of insecurity is without trust. So if control was power, and you, most people who are insecure have a lot of control. They do a lot of controlling. They do a lot of manipulating. You would feel your power if that was the key. But the more control you have, don't you notice the more control you need? That you never have enough? When you start learning to trust is when you really start getting present to your power. Because wherever there's control, there is no trust. And wherever there's trust, there's no control. So you got to make your choice. Do you want to experience real power that helps you to stand in your integrity? Or do you want to keep chasing behind an illusion? Remember, all of our resources come from where? Our relationships, the one with yourself too, but it comes from our relationships. So relationships don't work well at all with control. We discovered that at the very beginning. Nobody in this room wants to be controlled. But everybody in this room wants to be trusted. We need to work to build trust so we can help everybody get a sense of what their power is, because it's through us trusting one another that we develop and build power. We don't build power by controlling people. I want you to keep that in mind. Does anybody have any questions before I shut it down? Any questions or comments or anything you want me to clarify a little more?
About goals and goals for power.
Goals, what you mean?
How will we use the power when we get it?
Well, we normally use power for the most important thing, fulfilling ourselves. Fulfilling ourselves. Because most of us exist most of our lives unfulfilled. And what we do is pretend. We pretend or we go silent. We pretend as if we got it or we don't say nothing at all. But most of us, the reality is, you know, and I know this only because people tell me intimate secrets. Because I'm a coach and I work with people and they disclose stuff. Most people are not authentic. Which means most people are not in their power. Because when you're being authentic, you're in your power. And the life occurs completely differently when you're authentic. It's institutional. It's built in the institutions, but because we've been so socialized by these institutions, it occurs as a disease. Yes. Question?
So I guess stating as a woman, power is not something that is very well received. So I think that's something that I struggle with on a regular and told I have to quiet myself not to crush delicate flowers.
Listen. When my daughter had a power conversation with me, and that's what she was saying, look, I'm gonna start doing my thing. I want your support, but I'm gonna start doing my thing. And to prove it to me, when I got back from the training after that conversation, she had cut all her hair off. You know what she says? I've just liberated myself. She said, because I felt oppressed for many years behind this hair. She cut all the perm out of her hair and went natural. He said, Mom and Dad, if y'all don't like it, tough. Now, see, that's the problem we're going to start experiencing, because there are some people that have been like parents that are not used to their children having power. I had to adjust to her having her own voice. And guess what? It's something we got to do. Everybody going to have to adjust to people finding their own voice, to people coming into their power, because we're not used to it. We're used to people just going along with things. We're not used to people feeling enough and acting enough. We don't even have the language to identify and to communicate and to grow the idea of people feeling and acting enough. Most of us act like we're not enough all the time. It's exhausting. Imagine how much weight you're carrying with trying to please people every day. That's a lot of weight. You're walking around and you got the whole thing on your back. Oh, Lord. But you're standing up like you fronting like you're really cool.
How does this translate to our government, our institutions that seem to suppress a portion of people?
Okay, well, it translates to exactly what I was saying in terms of from the very beginning. One of the things that racism was designed to do was to make power invisible, so that one group will be able to rule and have all the power. And we see ourselves as having no power at all, but institutions get their power from us. So institutions didn't want us to know that it's getting its power from us. But if you don't own your own power, then you can't hold institutions accountable. We can't organize. If we don't have a sense of our own power, we come and be destructive with one another. See, it's us feeling and thinking we're not enough that makes us act so ugly with each other. Because we're all trying to prove we're something, this, that, or other, rather than seeing ourselves as being powerful people, and we're coming together because we all are enough, right? And we start moving and organizing to undo or to transform institutions because we know we have power, that the institutions cannot exist without us. Institutions have been doing what they've been doing in our name with our power. But it has done a good job of keeping it invisible from us so we wouldn't know that we have the power to hold institutions accountable. Over here, what's your question?
Being a person that knows your power and your assets and your worth, how do you individually every day deal with people who are adverse towards you when you share your assets, your knowledge?
Well, I say this, I meet people that play haters. Have you seen my play haters? I meet them all the time. You need them. They're necessary. That's right. I'm gonna tell you why they need it necessary, because they will pump you up more than the people who are on your side. That's the thing I want you to get. You gotta get out of wanting everybody to like you. You have not been designed to be liked by everybody. Some people are gonna like you, some people ain't. And guess what? I gave up that business. I'm not even in that business no more. You don't have to like me. I'm still going to be enough. Because my children told me, my daughters, my two younger daughters, said, Daddy, we don't need you to be good. We need you to be great. That's why I put them on that slide, so they remind me, in case I get up here and want to start acting good. They said, Daddy, we need you to be great. Listen, we all need to be great. The problem is there are too many good people. It's good people who sit down watching all this stuff go on. Good people. Good people. Hell with that. It's time for us to be great. Good is the enemy of great. And great people do not do what good people do. They have higher standards. They expect more of themselves. They know what their resources are. And they're working to build and create together. We need to be creating and building together. Any other questions? Since you have one, you got a question?
So knowing how intuitive and perceptive you are, as I've observed you training workshops, can you share how these principles relate to having a discussion about race and racism in a mixed group?
Good, that's a good question. So. The first one I gave you on the five things I gave you about translating meaning, that is so important in terms of beginning to be able to talk about racism and race. Because most of the time when we are in mixed company, like mixed race company, as a person of color or as a white person, we really don't say what things mean to us. Because we're so worried about what the other person is going to think or what they're going to feel, and we got to be willing to take a little risk. And sometimes it may be uncomfortable in the beginning, but it's the beginning of a real conversation. Get that most of our conversations are so fake that we don't even know each other. We be around each other all the time and just faking and fronting all day. This is why we're in the condition we're in, because racism does a good job of making sure that we have inauthentic relationships. So you taking that first step, which is translating what things mean to you. It can be very fearful. Because what things may mean to you may cause upset with someone else. But if you're really in a relationship and you share that, let's talk about it. Knowing that we all growing, we all are trying to grow. And get this other thing too, because I think this is very important, that you remember that no one grows in your face. Stop expecting to say something and all of a sudden somebody going, like a microwave popcorn going to pop up all of a sudden. I got it. Stop expecting that. Give people some room to grow. You share stuff with people and you step away and give them an opportunity to grow and accept what you've said or to even challenge what you said. And get that if people don't agree with you fully, that don't mean a bad thing. I want somebody to be honest with me. If you don't agree with me, don't agree with me. But I know this thing. I know when I ring a bell, it can't be unrung. Here's the thing that we got to get. We have to get present to our power. We got to own our own power, which we haven't done yet. Because let me tell you something. A great portion of the work that we do has been about proving to white people that racism exists. Right? But meanwhile, because we've had to, meanwhile, we haven't been doing any work on the back end. And the work on the back end is us undoing the damage that has been done by internalized oppression, inferiority, as a result of us not owning our power. So we got to do that work on the back end, which we haven't been doing, because if we own our power, things change in your community, in our communities, when we own our power. Tulsa, Oklahoma is a good example of that, what they did when they owned their power. But we have not been owning our power. We've been distracted from it. But we got to get focused on, that's why I call it the elephant in the room. We got to start talking about power. We got to start inviting people to the conversation of power. How do we build our power? How do we learn to start trusting each other? Because we're not going to do it if we don't trust each other. Nobody going to come in our community and do it for us. We can wait till the cows come home. And going up against the tide to get to our power, because that's what institutions and systems don't want you to see. They don't want you to become present to your power. Because that's the only way you can transform. That's the only way we can transform our communities, is if we get a sense of our own power and start trusting and building with each other. When we get into the mindset where we are following and observing what I call superior principles, everything starts changing. But right now we're following inferior principles. We live by inferior principles. That's why we don't have a sense of our own power. That it's at the point where we own our power as people of color that we can come to together with white people authentically. Because see, as we come together and we're not owning our power, we're inauthentic with each other, we're making agreements that's not going to stand anyway. Because at the end of the day, we're not going to show up for each other unless we are coming from an authentic place, which is a place of our power. We got to get to that place where we are being authentic with each other and courageous enough to be authentic enough to have some real progress. Until then, we're just wasting our time talking to each other. I'm going to be honest with you. Unless we were talking to each other in order to get to that place where we're owning our own power. But we all got to be supportive of each other owning our own power, because our communities need it. Our world needs it. Our world needs powerful people, and that's us.